Good morning, church family. Really great to be together with you today, whether in person or online. We are so glad that you're part of the First Baptist community. And we just want to encourage you to take out your phones and to let us know that you're here. You can text the word attend if you regularly attend. It's okay to take them out now if you'd like. Text the word attend to 275-5410. 275-5410. And if you're new with us, first, second, third time, and new, kind of newer to our community here, we'd love for you to text the word hello. We just want to get to know you a little bit and connect with you. So we're really glad that you are here, and we pray that the Lord would work in your hearts and your minds in a great way today. There are a couple opportunities for some community coming up. You know, we miss a lot of fun activities, events, different things. So next Sunday, we are going to have our First Baptist Church picnic outside, and we'll have a box lunch for you. It's $5, and we would encourage you to come. We'll be socially distanced, and we'll have some good food, and we'll have good church family around. There's a lot of people signing up already, so I encourage you to sign up if you'd like to come. And there will also be we used to call it concurrent services, but simultaneous services at 10:30, right, Pastor? 10:30 next week, and we won't have this early time, right? So we have 10:30 service. So if you come at 9 o'clock next week, you're going to be coming really early. So next week, be sure to come at 10:30, and then afterwards we'll have the church picnic. So you have until Thursday to register online, or let us know if you're coming so we can make sure that we have a box lunch for you. It's going to be a great time. Another great opportunity, and you might want to pass the word on, even if you don't want to come, or if you do want to come, bring some family with you. We're going to have our first of 3 movie nights outside. We have an outdoor setup where we can have a big screen and movie and, you know, big audio. And the first movie that we're going to do, and I'm very excited, this is definitely one of my favorites, is Remember the Titans. And it's going to be great. We're going to do it kind of over here between the church and the park. It's going to be a great time. It could be a great opportunity to reach out to someone. And we should call this a pre-evangelistic opportunity. If you want to have someone come along too that maybe doesn't like to come to church, this would be a great opportunity just to kind of get to know and see some of the people and just have a really good time together. That is free, so I encourage you to be sure you mark that down. For today's service, and if you're at home, I would encourage you to get your elements ready, because this is a communion service, a special time, and we want you to be able to also be part of that. So you should do that during this time so that you can participate after the sermon with communion. At this time, let us slow down and just kind of set our hearts and minds upon the Lord and prepare our hearts to worship together. Set of verses in chapter 3 of Colossians, and this is one of the verses that I want to encourage us with today. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms and hymns, spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, whether in word or in deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Let us worship together and remember that. Let the Lord and his word dwell richly within us.
Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you that we are able to come together and to worship you. We worship you in spirit and in truth. God, we thank you for your perfect love that casts out fear. God, we know that there's a lot of fear going around about different things. Virus and job security and relationships and lack of regular social contact. And God, we pray against that in the name of Jesus. We thank you that your perfect love casts out fear. God, we pray for those who are hurting. God, we pray, Lord, that you would touch our hearts and our minds as we are hurting. For God, you know, and you call us to cast our burdens upon you, and you care for us. We cry out to you, God, in this time. And Father, we think of those who are serving this country in the military, too, God. We lift them up to you right now. And they may be far from home or in a challenging situation. Most likely they are in a challenging situation if they're serving. So God, we pray for that, that you would not only help them through it, but help them to keep their mind upon you and their hearts drawn to you. God, we pray for those who are far from you. And God, we pray that you would draw them back to yourself. That you would touch them. You would touch them deeply, Lord. And Father, we pray for our church, Lord, as we go forward. May we be a light into the world as you've called us to be. Jesus said, I'm the light of the world, but he also said to his disciples, you are the light of the world. So God, we pray for that, that we could be light that shines before people. And that people can be drawn to you because of the lives that we're living. Though we're imperfect, we are striving to live for you, to be unselfish, to be loving, to be servant-minded in all that we do. So God, I pray for that, that you would give that to us. Lord God, we love you and we thank you. And we pray that you will be with us in a special way. We know that you are with us. You walk with us. Your spirit lives within us when we trust in you. The Heavenly Father, we pray that you would just let us know that you are Lord and that you love us and that we are yours. We love you. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
On this Labor Day weekend, our scripture reading is taken from 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, beginning our reading in verse 6. 2 Thessalonians 3 and verse 6. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we command you, brothers and sisters, to keep away from every believer who is idle and disruptive and does not live according to the teachings that you have received from us. For you yourselves know how you ought to follow our example. We were not idle when we were with you, nor did we eat anyone's food without paying for it. On the contrary, we worked day and night, laboring and toiling, so that we would not be a burden to any of you. We did this not because we do not have the right to ask for such help, but in order to offer ourselves as a model for you to imitate. For even when we were with you, we gave you this rule: the one who is unwilling to work shall not eat. We hear that some among you are idle and disruptive. They are not busy, they are busybodies. Such people we command and urge in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to settle down and to earn the food that they eat. And as for you, brothers and sisters, never tire of doing what is good. Take special note of anyone who does not obey our instruction in this letter. Do not associate with them, in order that they might feel ashamed. Yet, do not regard them as an enemy, but warn them as you would a fellow believer. Now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace at all times and in every way. The Lord be with all of you. Let us prepare ourselves for communion. Reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and he said, "This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sin against the blood and the body of our Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment upon themselves. Shall we pray? Lord Jesus, there is a danger in going through this holy act so many times that we don't even stop to contemplate and reflect upon what we are doing. What we are doing, Lord Jesus, has only been made possible because of what you have already done. A narrative that we have heard so many times before that we may jump through the hoops without really reflecting. Please don't allow that to happen to us this morning. May your Holy Spirit work deeply within our hearts to fill us, O Lord, with the spirit of confession and affirmation and ultimately reception of your grace or the anticipation of your return. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Jesus said, "This is my body broken for you." Let us see. And then he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Whenever you drink it, do so in remembrance of me." question that we ponder this morning from 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 is the question, why work? There is a story about a husband and his wife who went to visit their doctor. Partway through their appointment, the physician asked the husband to please leave his office. He needed to speak alone to the wife. "Madam," he said, "I'm afraid that I have some very bad news for you. Your husband is very, very sick. And he's probably not going to live very long." "Oh," she said, "I'm so sorry to hear that. Is there anything at all that I can possibly do?" To which he said, "Well, I'm glad that you asked, because yes, there is something that you can do in order to help him live longer. And if you are willing to follow my advice, your husband will live another 25 years. "What do I have to do?" she said. To which the doctor said, "You have to do all of the work around the house. You have to do everything. You have to allow your husband to sit back and to relax. Let him sleep in as late as he wants to. Fix his final meals. Allow him to watch every single sporting event that is on television. Do all of the work around the house. Do all of the cleaning, do all of the laundry, do all of the ironing, cut the grass, pull the weeds, maintain the flowers, paint the walls. You have to do everything around the house. Do all of the work." "And what will happen if I don't do all of the work?" she said, to which the doctor said, "Well, as I've already told you, your husband will probably be gone in another 6 months, so be sure that you do everything." As they were driving home, there was a sense of awkward silence that filled the air in the car, at which point her husband asked her, "I need to know, what did the doctor tell you?" To which she said, "Honey, I'm sorry, but you're going to be dead in 6 months." Have you ever known anyone who just doesn't like to work? Anyone who, every time the alarm clock goes off, as soon as their feet hit the floor, they're filled with one complaint after another that I have to go to work today. A recent poll in Forbes magazine indicated that 80% of all Americans have that attitude towards work. "I don't like working." A couple of years ago, the Washington Post shared a humorous article around Labor Day in which the writer shared some rather humorous reasons as to why it is that some people tend to show up at work late in the morning. Some of those excuses were quite predictable. Things like the traffic was heavy, the weather was bad, the bus was late. But there were several reasons that were also quite humorous. For example, there was the lady who said, "I'm sorry that I'm late for work today, but my fake eyelashes got caught together and I couldn't pull them apart." Or the person who said, "I was out of the parking lot, I jumped out of the car, I looked down and I discovered that my shoes didn't match." Or one of my all-time favorites, the person who said, "My left turn signal is broken and I can only take right turns." Well, as humorous as some of those excuses might be, the excuse that the Apostle Paul is dealing with here in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 may be nearly as funny. We know from our reading back in 1 Thessalonians, as well as certain sections in 2 Thessalonians, that the Christians at the church at Thessalonica were anticipating the second coming of Jesus Christ, which is a very, very, very good thing. But it seems as though they were filled with so much anticipation of the second coming of Christ that they were using that hope and that anticipation as an excuse for not working. Why work? Why worry about what happens in this world? If Jesus Christ is going to come back, if he is going to bring his kingdom to bear, if there is a possibility that the world as you and I know it right now is no longer going to exist, then why even worry about it? Why work? Jesus is coming again. It sort of reminds me of something that I tried when I was a little boy. We were sitting down at the supper table one night. My mother had prepared pork chops, mashed potatoes, vegetable salad, and dessert, chocolate cake and vanilla ice cream. My suggestion to her, let's eat the dessert first. To which she said, no, that isn't the way that we do things in this house. To which I said, well, what if Jesus comes back before we're done? It didn't work then, and it didn't work for Paul. Why work if Jesus Christ is going to come? Why work? What's the motivation behind working? Should we work just in order to get a paycheck? Should we work hoping that we will be able to build our retirement accounts to be enough so that we could retire early? Is that why we work? Or is it possible that as believers in Christ, there are deeper reasons in mind? Why work? Why work? Because work is a chance to reflect the nature of God. Work is an opportunity for us to reflect his character in what we do. The Apostle Paul was a very, very humble servant of the gospel of Jesus Christ. He was so humble, in fact, that at one point he referred to himself as being the chief among sinners. He was so humble that he was willing to make himself vulnerable in confessing his struggles. In the book of Romans, for example, he said, I do the things that I don't want to do. But even though the Apostle Paul was an incredibly humble servant, the Apostle Paul was still willing to say to the church, follow my example, follow me. Do as I do. That's precisely what he says here in verse 7, when he says, for you yourselves know how you need to follow our example. Follow me, do as I do. Now, at first glance, you might hear that and think, Chuck, you said that Paul was humble, but that sounds rather arrogant and self-serving to me. But you need to remember that back in Corinthians chapter 11 in verse 1, the Apostle Paul also said, follow me, but he also went on to say, follow me as I follow Christ. So when Paul is writing here to the church of Thessalonica and he is saying, follow me and do as I do, make sure that you reflect my example, he does so with the understanding that he can call people to follow his example of working because Christ, God, was a worker himself. God is a worker, and when we work, we have an opportunity to reflect the nature of God. And furthermore, God did not just work as we read in the book of Genesis that he worked when he created the heavens and he created the earth and he created you and me in his image. It isn't just that God worked, but God is still working today. Sometimes I think we read through the opening chapters of the book of Genesis and we have a misunderstanding of what it means when he said that after 6 days, God rested. A
I think the understanding that we sometimes have is that God got done working, and then he turned to Jesus, and he turned to the Holy Spirit, and he said, oh, I'm glad that's over. Now I can sit back and relax for eternity. But that isn't what the Bible teaches. God is still working. Colossians chapter 1, for example, Paul writes, God created all things, those things that are visible and those things that are invisible, and he holds all things together today. Or the words of David in Psalm 104, he sends forth springs into the valleys that provide drink to the beasts of the fields. He causes the grass to grow for the cattle. Oh Lord, how marvelous are the works of your hands. Every time we work, whether we are working at a job or whether we are working in a volunteer capacity, any time that we work to do anything, it is an opportunity to reflect his character in our lives. Work is also a chance for us to redeem God's gift of time. Time is one of the most precious commodities that we have. We never seem to have enough of it. But do you realize how quickly time goes by? In the New Testament, the writer says that our lives are like a vapor, meaning they are here one moment and then they are gone. In the Psalms, it is David who says that our lives are like grass that grows in the morning and it flourishes, but soon we are cut down, it withers away, then we must leave. The question for us then is, what are we going to do with God's gift of time? Are we going to be idle and do nothing? Or are we going to work? When Paul wrote these words to this church, he pinpointed two specific issues. The first one is mentioned in verse 6 when he refers to people who are idle, which is a nice way of saying they're lazy. But then he also goes on in verse 6 and he refers to people who are disruptive. What does it mean to be disruptive? He describes in verse 11 what it means to be disruptive when he says, there are people who are idle and disruptive. They are not busy, but they are busybodies. To be a busybody does not mean that you are busy with your body. It just means that you are busy with one part of your body. It's called the mouth. What is a busybody? A busybody is a person who likes to gossip. It was a problem back in the days of Paul. I'm so glad that in the life of the church that is no longer a problem today. But it also meant something else. To be a busybody meant that they spent all of their time talking and they never seemed to get around to doing. Have you ever known anybody like that? They talk and they talk and they talk. They talk about their goals, they talk about their aspirations, they talk about their plans, they talk about their dreams, and they never seem to get beyond the talking and taking the step of doing. Haven't you ever encountered at least one person of which you have wanted to ask them, well, when are you going to do it? Make the greatest use of your time. Have you ever known anyone who is older and they look back on their lives with a sense of regret and they tend to say something like, oh, I have just wasted my life. How does a person get to the point in which they have wasted their lives? It isn't something that just happens overnight. A person wastes their lives when they have wasted their years. And they waste their years when they have wasted their months, and they waste their months when they have wasted their weeks, and they waste their weeks when they have wasted their days, and they waste their days when they have wasted their hours, and they waste their hours when they have wasted their minutes, and they waste their minutes when they have wasted their seconds. Make the best use of your time. It is a gift from God. Why work? Because work is an opportunity to reflect the nature of God, to redeem God's gift of time. Three, we work because it provides us with the resources to reach others with the message of Christ. Paul says here in verse 8 that he was willing to work, so he didn't have to ask these people to provide him with resources. He mentions in verse 8 that he was willing to work day and night, laboring and toiling in the work that he did. What was the work that he did besides being a missionary or being a pastor? We know from other parts of the reading in the New Testament that the Apostle Paul made his living by producing tents. He was a tent maker, and he sold the tents in order to secure some money. But in making tents, he not only made tents with the goal of making money, but he made the tents to make money, knowing that he would then have the resources so that his life could become a conduit or a channel in reaching other people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. When we work, God provides us with resources so that we can reach others with the good news of Christ. And you might be thinking, Chuck, how does this apply to me? I'm not a tent maker. I'm not a bivocational pastor, and I certainly have no desire to become one. So what on earth does this mean for me? What resource does God give to you when you work at a place of employment? Or if you worked at a place of employment, and now you are receiving benefits from the job that you did? He provides you with the resource of money. Are you aware that if you did not work and did not have that resource of money, that the church around the world would not have an opportunity to touch lives with the gospel? It just would not take place. I've been doing a lot of reading over the past several months as to how churches around the United States have been dealing with this crazy pandemic and its impact upon the life of the church. There is the overall consensus that even when the pandemic is over and a vaccination is discovered, that the church probably will never go back to the way it used to be. Some of the changes are probably going to be permanent. Thank God one of them will not be you'll have to wear a mask. Out of all of the articles that I've read, there has been a strong opinion that 94% of the churches in the United States have been negatively impacted by this pandemic. It is shown both in attendance, in which only 6% of all the churches have seen their attendance return to the same patterns that they were before the pandemic occurred. But here's the other interesting statistic. The vast majority of the churches are indicating that they are facing some rather serious financial repercussions because individuals have quit giving during this pandemic. Now, fortunately, we're doing pretty good here, and for that, we're thankful. Now, here's what I also found to be very, very interesting in reading this particular article that was found in a Christian magazine. They were talking to individuals about their pattern of giving, and one individual said, I don't give to my church during the pandemic because I'm not getting anything. I don't go to church, therefore I'm not giving. I thought that was an interesting perspective because biblically and theologically it is wrong in two different ways. Number one, it fails to really understand the true motivation for giving. We don't give in order to get. We don't give because we want to receive. But we give as an act of our worship and love and desire to honor and to glorify God. That's always the motivation for giving. And the second thing that that perspective overlooks is the fact that the church is still ministering and the gospel is still being shared. Let me give you an illustration of this, something that happened right here at First Baptist just 2 weeks ago when one of our staff members, through a Zoom conversation, led somebody to Jesus Christ. Leading somebody to Christ while talking to them on a screen. Your giving enables that staff person to still be employed. Your giving enables the electricity bill to be paid so that the Zoom call could take place. Your giving enables us to have up-to-date computer systems so that we can communicate in creative ways. Your giving enables us to pay the bill so that the Zoom license could be secured. When you work and you give, you are touching other people for Christ. Why work? Because work is an opportunity to reflect the nature of God. Because work is an opportunity to redeem God's gift of time. Because work enables us to reach others with the message of the gospel. And why work? Because work reduces our dependency on others. Paul says here in verse 8, I do not want to be a burden to you. I worked and I toiled all day and all night long because I didn't want to be a burden to you. Now, don't get Paul wrong. Don't judge him. Paul is not saying here that it's wrong to receive assistance, that it's wrong to help individuals in need. In fact, in 1 Corinthians, the Apostle Paul commends the Christians at the Church of Macedonia because they were willing to make significant sacrifices in order to serve the needs of the church back in Jerusalem when Jerusalem was going through impoverished times. In the book of Acts, we read that they shared everything in common. There's nothing wrong with giving to people in need, and there's nothing wrong with receiving those gifts when God sends them our way. But what is the danger of that particular pattern being practiced over the long haul? What happens when a person becomes overly dependent? What does it do to their sense of esteem? What does it do to their personal well-being, spiritually, relationally, emotionally speaking? It seriously is hurt. Which is why it is that the pattern that God has ordained is to receive and to give when absolutely necessary, but don't allow that to become the default mode in your life. Go and work. I have a colleague, friend of mine, who serves a church in one of the toughest parts of the city of Chicago that you can imagine. He has been at this church for over 25 years. The community is the same community where my son Michael is a pastor. The community is called Lawndale. 25 years ago, when he went to Lawndale, he realized that the only way that he would really be able to influence the community for Christ was if he also met some of the community's needs. He was concerned about the environment, the crime, drugs, prostitution, and the like. So he raised the money from some friends and donors to purchase a building where he decided that they would start a new church. But he didn't stop there. They went on and they purchased building after building after building after building until they got to the point in which they literally owned the entire city block. And do you know what he did? He not only had the church, but they started a medical clinic. They started a Christian school. They started a pizza parlor. They opened the doors to a new restaurant. They opened the doors to a grocery store. And do you know what happened? The number of people in his church who approached him and said to him, "Would you just give something to me?" went way down. And the people in the life of that church found gainful employment and a sense of significance, and those people's sense of well-being was restored. When you work, you reduce your dependency on others. Why work? Because it's an opportunity to reflect the character of God. It's an opportunity to redeem God's gift of time. It's an opportunity to reach out to others with the message of Christ. And it's an opportunity to reduce our dependency on other people. I guess as you don't know the name of Bill Henson, or if you know the name of Bill Henson, it's probably not this Bill Henson. Bill Henson is 100 years old. He lives in New York. And last year, as he was getting ready to celebrate his 100th birthday, his family said to him, "Dad, what do you want to do to celebrate? Let's do something really special." And Bill said, "I want to go back to work." "What? Why would you want to go back to work?" "Because," he said, "I retired much, much too early." How old was he when he retired? 97. And his former boss, he worked for an HVAC company, hired him back and gave him a paycheck for working 30 minutes on his 100th day. Wouldn't it be great to have that sort of an enthusiastic, positive attitude towards working in life, whether we get paid or we are serving of the kindness of our hearts? Happy Labor Day! Or, happy Labor Day. You tell me. Shall we pray? Lord, for blessing us, for gifting us with this marvelous thing we call work, we thank you. Forgive us for the times in which we have lost the biblical perspective. And help us, Lord, to seize every opportunity to work and to serve as a chance to follow the patterns of Scripture. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and go being filled with the presence of his Holy Spirit, who sustains and strengthens you in all of the work that you do. Go in his peace.